Hey everybody, this is FTLAK for the Love Alaska. Today I'm going to go through and I'm going to show you the settings that I have set up for my base. And just kind of go through and talk about some of the basic settings. So we're going to start a new world. You have to start with picking your play style, social, cooperative, competitive, or madness. What's really funny is this will help with some settings. I really just always set it to madness because, you know, it's a crazy world out there. It's Don't Starve. You have to choose your world name. You can add a description. This, if you're playing on public servers, is really good. Kind of tell people what you're all about and what you're trying to do and accomplish. If it's your first time trying to kill a certain boss or accomplish any certain task, playing in the new farming style, so on and so forth. You can pick if it's public, friends only, or local. Today we're just going to go local. And then you have your game mode. So your game modes, survival. We survive together, we die together. This is a very fun mode. It's not one that I typically put on. Once somebody dies, everybody starts to lose sanity. It's definitely more challenging, but not the best way for me to start out. For a lot of mega-base worlds, it's typically not what's used. Again, these are all my opinions, and everybody plays differently. Wilderness, which if you've ever watched one of my Wilderness Wednesdays, it's a dangerous world. There's no, like, portal. There's no way for you to enter or change characters. Basically, you enter the world in a random location, no safety net. If you die, you get to try again. The best part about this is when you die, you do get to select your character again. You do lose your map and anything that you had pre-built, but it's a lot of fun and is a different way of playing. And my favorite mode, which is typically what we're on, is Endless. Endless is a never-ending Don't Starve sandbox. For anybody who likes to play in other games in sandbox mode, this is definitely going to be the mode for you. You come through the floored postern. When you become a ghost, you die. No one loses sanity, and you have many ways that you can be revived. You can go all the way back to where you started and, you know, be revived, or you can get to a touchstone. There's other options and ways throughout the game that you can be revived. So, Endless, you can turn PvP on or off. That just allows other players to hit you. I turn this off for the sole fact that even by accident, some of the buttons mapping for console are the same to open a chest and to hit a player, or to use an item or to hit a player. So you can decide your player number. The max currently for console is 6. On Steam, I believe this is the same as well. There are mods available for you to actually switch. Going over to our next tab, there's a couple of things to keep in mind here. So you've got world generation. These are all settings that you can only set the first time you go into the world. World settings, you can change every time you re-enter the world. So if you decide, hey, I want to change a season, it's too long, it's too short, you can change that with the new update. With world gen, these are your starting settings. So I always start here. So season start, you can pick autumn, winter, spring, spring or autumn, winter or summer, or random. By default, you're set to autumn, which is where I kind of leave it. For a lot of people that memorize how many days and things go on, it makes it easier for you to remember. The next world settings is biomes. Biomes, you can choose classic. So this is the classic Don't Starve biomes, or together. Together added in some new biomes. You can find out which one's on the wiki, but having the together biomes is a lot more fun. It gives you more of gameplay. Your spawn area, if anybody's seen me start a new world, the spawn area by default is just nothing. You have the options for plus. Plus is actually going to give you 3 chests filled with basic tools, basic supplies. When I first started playing, I never used this setting. And then after I started surviving past day 50, I realized turning on the plus settings just basically makes it so you can build a base up very quickly and efficiently within the first 20 days. And it gives you time to kind of explore and do other things. So plus is usually what I have mine set to constantly now. You've also got dark, so if you've ever played through the original Don't Starve, you can have it where there is no sunlight. Dark is a challenging mode, but a lot of fun. and definitely something you should experience at least once. So I'm gonna leave it on plus. Your world size, so default, big, are the two that you have for console. On PC, you actually have a couple other options available to you. I'm gonna leave mine on big. So on our branches, this is the way that your world is gonna be shaped. Of course, it's all randomized, but you can have branches on never, least, default, most, or random. I'm actually gonna turn branches on most. I like to have big, long branches kind of sprawling out. Loops, if you want a circle world, you can put always, but with all these settings, there's videos just on these two setting combinations. I would definitely look those up if you're trying to find a world style that you like. I don't like the big donut worlds because they're never connected. I actually prefer branches most and loops never. The main reason is I can build boats in between two platforms and make a larger circle if I needed to. And then I can always run to the center. And the center of the map is kind of set up like a clock to where I can run north to one, east to another biome, south to a biome, and so forth. Touchstones, this is a way for you to revive in world. You can have it on none. You can have it on little. You might get one, possibly two. You can have it on less. You can have it on default or more. I'm going to turn it on more. I think even in my world gens, I still only see upwards of 3 to 4 on console. You will see more on PC. PCs obviously have more computing power and are going to be able to have more of this more. No, on console, what I've learned is every time you turn something on more, it's turning something naturally in the world down. Doesn't show it on here, but that's just my opinion. So, Fallen Survivors, these are people that tried before you and didn't make it, but they left you some goodies behind. You can have this on none, little, less, default, or more. We're going to turn it on more, just because it's nice to get a couple extra added items. This is also where you can get some extra items early game that you might not get later. There is a Fallen Survivor that has a walking cane, which is a beautiful item you can't get until your first winter, so the fact that you can get it in the first 20 days is fantastic. Starting resource variety. This is typically for me set to default. I have classic version, which is just classic don't starve, and then you have highly randomized or random, which is going to randomize everything for you in the world. Your celestial visures, you can have it on less, you can have it on little, you can have it on none or more. We're just going to leave that on default. And then your resources. So let's go down to our list of resources here. So anemones, which are found on Lunar Island, and I know you guys are going to beat me up in the comments. It's probably not how it's pronounced, but I apologize. We're going to turn that on more. Those are fun. They're kind of like a never-ending tooth trap, also used in multiple things like Volt Goat farming. Bull kelp. I main as wart, so I love turning this on more. You can turn both of these to little, none, or less. But bull kelp is a great resource. If you can get that within the first 50 to 100 days, it will help you fantastically. Berry bushes. Again, you can put on more, default, less, or little, or none. I'm going to put that just on default. We're just going to kind of go down. So we've got cacti. This is in the Dragonfly Desert. Again, more, less, little. We're going to leave that on default. Bull kelp out at sea. So these are ones that you can't pick and replant. These are just ones out in the ocean. I'm going to just leave that on default. Boulders. I always seem to be out of rocks, so I'm going to hit more. Carrots. We're going to leave that on default. Flint. Amazingly enough, I put this on little. You will always have too much flint. For whatever reason, this is a resource that isn't used in too many recipes. Once you start making gold tools, you really need less flint. We've got evil flowers and flowers. This is a fun one. I put it on more. If you want to see more butterflies, you can just add more butterflies as well. You can leave it on default. We'll put it on default today. Lunar rocks, we're gonna leave on default. Hot springs, these are both Lunar Island items. I'm gonna leave those on default. Grass, we're gonna leave on default. Lunar saplings, default. Lunar trees, these are all gonna be the same, more or less. Meteor fields are very nice because it gives you the ability to get rocks even after you've mined everything on the surface. I leave this on default. just for the sole fact that they can be painful if it's close to an area that you would like to build your base, but it's nice to have kind of an incoming rock every, you know, handful of days that they allow you to put it on, depending on your settings. You've got ponds, you've got mushrooms, mini glaciers, which only come out through the winter. You've got reeds, which I play as wort, so this is always hit to more. Saplings, which sometimes I'll actually put to less or little. Sea stacks, which are the rocks out at sea. If you're not a good sailor, it might be smart to put this on none to start. But as you grow and develop your skills, it's nice to move it to less, to little to less, to default to more. This is another form of rocks that you can also collect throughout the game. Trees, more, little less. I leave this on default. Stone fruit bushes, I turn this to more. The sole reason I turn this to more is when I'm on Lunar, I will pick every single one. I don't actually dig up the trees and bring them back because then they require fertilizer. If you pick the stone fruit trees and get a seed, that will not require fertilizer. If it does wilt during the summer, you will have to fertilize it then, but it's not required after picking X number of stone fruits. Spiky bushes I typically leave on default. Even though I go tumbleweeding all the time in my worlds, this is typically set to default. You can put it to more, and on PC, I believe you can actually even move it as high as insane. That was a lot of fun the first time I did that on PC. They're just in every single biome and all over the place. It can cause a lot of lag. It is a moving item. You can turn these to less, little, or none. Tumbleweeds is where you can actually get some early game gears. So if you're struggling to kill, you know, that first boss or monster to get you a gear, you can kind of go tumbleweeding to get you one. I like to go because it's kind of like opening a gift every time you catch a tumbleweed. Sometimes you'll have blueprints, sometimes you'll have other things that just might be really enjoyable and fun for you. Creatures. So we've got beehives, which are all spread out throughout the world. Sometimes you can even get a bee biome. These are all the same settings. None, little, more, less. This is all you get on console. I'm sorry. You've got beefalo, which I like to turn to more. Sometimes, lately I've been just leaving it on default. I rely too heavily on beefalo. So I'm trying to keep more of my settings going to default. Buzzards, default. Moles, default. We've got our hollow swamps, which has our little cats in them. I leave those just at default. Carrots, which are just adorable. They're on Lunar. There's really not a big use for them. I leave on default. Pig houses, even though merms and pigs are enemies, I do leave this on default just because where they spawn is where they spawn. If I do decide to break it down, I am getting some boards and some rocks. Rabbit holes default, salamanders default, lobster mounds. If I wanted to go lobster fishing, I might put this on more just for fun, but the fact that they are meat and I don't utilize them, I leave it on default. Volt goats, you can leave on default as well. Your shallows, which is your fish spawn areas out in the ocean, I leave on default. Clockworks, so these are our hostile creatures. Clockworks, so the ones that you have to try and beat. This is a good one to learn and practice to kite on because it's a very easy kiting pattern once you get used to it. But you can leave this on default. You can, of course, put them to more. Typically, I get lucky and get gear within my first 5 or 6 tumbleweeds. Hound mounds, which spawn hounds. They're typically not too bad. It will spawn a hound if you hit it close, just like a spider nest. You'll have extra hounds come out and start to chase you. But nothing that you can't handle, and you can remove these later in life in the game if you would like. Killer beehives, I leave on default. The seaweeds, I leave on default. McTusk, I joke and always put this on more, and I still generate worlds that only have one. I don't know if this is just a console issue, but it seems to be, for whatever reason, the way that my worlds gen. Leaky shacks, which will release a merm, and if you hit the merm close to the leaky shack, 4 more, or 3 more will come out, so you'll have a total of 4. I actually turn this to more. In most of my swamps, I usually don't have too many, So it's nice to have one or two. If I do bring a boss like Berger or Deerclops out there and he destroys one, this is something that you cannot bring back, even as you're not able to build a leaky shack. So they're very valuable to me. Other characters hate them and might just turn them off. Makes the swamp a little bit less dangerous. We've got our Shattered Spider Nest. This is on Lunar. You just leave this on default. Our Spider Dens. I think the game jokes with me. I have a lot of Weber players. I can put this on little and I will get more. If I put it on less, I will get more. If I put it on default, I get the default amount. If I put it on more, I get an insane amount. I think the game just jokes with me and knows that I don't want to deal with spiders. I've just decided to leave it on default. Tall birds. Depending on my world gen, I've been lucky and gotten the Tall Bird Fortress, which is a beautiful set piece of tall birds, which is fun to bring Berger and other bosses to. But typically I will leave this on default. I am a swamp dweller, but I will turn tentacles on more. I really enjoy having this for killing bosses and fighting other creatures. So this is my basic world gen. So let's go all the way up. So that's just for the world to generate, and then my world settings. So I leave my events on auto. You can go through and actually pick out the events that we've already had. So we've had our Midsummer Carnival, which was a blast. We had that in June of 2021. We've had Hallowed Nights. We've had Winter's Feast, Year of the Gobbler, Year of the Varg, Year of the Pig King, Year of the Carrot, Year of the Beefalo. These are events that you can schedule and just say, hey, I want to play this again. Or you can leave it on auto. If you leave it on auto, if I'm playing this world and in 6 weeks they release a new event, my world will then get that event if it is on auto. If you don't want it to do the event, you can turn it on none. This will prevent you from getting any of the events. Pretty self-explanatory, but kind of fun to know. You can go back. A lot of people really enjoy doing Winter's Feast, even before it comes out, just as a good refresher, because it is something that we typically get around the holiday season. Same with Hallowed Nights. And let's go over. You've got your global world settings for all of your seasons. So, autumn, I'm going to go through. All of these have none, very short, default, long, and very long, and then random. These are the console settings. So, the season lengths by days, just so you guys know. The season days, we're going to go through and just pretend. So none, obviously you will have no autumn. Very short, for spring, summer, autumn, and winter, this will be 5 days. For short, for spring, this will be 12 days. For summer, this will be 10 days. For autumn, this will be 5 days. And for winter, this will be 10 days. Default, so your default seasons, spring, will last 20 days. Summer will last 15 days. Autumn will last 20 days. And winter will last 15 days. So you can see spring and autumn match throughout. And then summer and winter match fairly close throughout. So if we were gonna go long, spring would be 31 days. Summer would be 22 days. Autumn would be 30 days. Winter will be 22 days. I'm going to put a link to the wiki down below so that you can check these out as well. There'll be other links in there as well with some valid resources, but the wiki is one of the best places to kind of check this out. And then finally, some of the settings, I'm going to go through and actually set these. So I actually set my autumn to very long. Very long is 50 days. So a lot of people come in and they're like, hey, it's day 21, why don't you have winter? Well, because I set spring and I set autumn to 50 days, which is very long. It makes for a really interesting year. My year is a lot longer than the average year because most people play at default. So if you went through all four seasons on default, you're looking at 70 days. Whereas if you set it to very long, you're looking at 180 days. So 1 year for me is 180 versus 70. It definitely makes for a different gameplay and different experience, but I enjoy autumn. It gives me more building time on console. I leave my winter at default, so that'll keep my winter at, yep, you guessed it, 15 days. Spring, I also will change. to very long. And my summer, because summer, if you've played the game, is a terrible, terrible thing. I don't leave it on none. When I first started playing, I always would die during summer. And I decided instead of stopping playing the game and not enjoying it, I turned it off. And then as things were added to summer, I was like, well, if I need that resource, I need to play during summer. So I moved it to very short, which was 5 days, but that's not enough to do all the things I need to. So I've moved it to short, and that's, you know, more time, but not necessarily all you need. So I'm working my way back to default, but currently I've had it set to short. A lot of people will just go down into the caves, which is something you can do. If you have it on default, then it'll make it easier for you. With 15 days, you just kind of mark the timer and come back in 15. We're gonna leave it on short today, just for the sole fact that this is my basic setup. So our very long autumn is 50 days. Our default winter is going to be 15 days. Our very long spring is also gonna be 50 days. And our short summer is gonna be 10 days. So that puts my world year at 75 total days, which isn't bad and it isn't fun. I mean, it's fun for me. It's different for everybody else. But play around with these. It'll definitely change the experience of the game for you. Day type. So you can have a very long day, long dark, long night, no day, no dusk, no night, only day, only dusk, only night. So this is kind of fun. If you wanted to play an only night version of the game, you have the capabilities to do so here. Only dusk, so that twilight time, which I know that some people have played this way. It's definitely a fun thing to experience. No night, when I really wanted to just practice building and doing things and get distracted reading the wiki or get distracted with something else. I knew that Charlie couldn't get me if I didn't have a knight, so I would really only die to starvation. I don't play this way anymore. It was just for me to kind of practice. It's a good way to kind of practice and just try things. No dusk, no day, long night, long dusk, long day. I actually leave it on long day. I like to have a longer time. It will still change during winter to be about half the day of winter at night, but long day will help me through spring and autumn a lot better. During summer, it does make it a little bit more difficult because it's hotter longer during the day, but it's the price that I pay. Your beefalo mating frequency, you can have it none, little, default, or more. This is good and bad. If you get a beefalo helmet, you're fine. If you don't have one and they're mating, they're going to try and hit you. So kind of choose accordingly. Your beefalo herds will only grow to a certain size on console, and then they start to slow down and stop. If you have it on none and you kill off all the beefalo, you're not getting any more. So I would recommend at least leaving this on little. I leave it on default. Crampi. So we've got our crampi here. Again, none, little, default, or more. I turn this on more. It makes it so I have a better opportunity to get, you know, a Krampus sack. It's a really low percentage chance, but it's nice to get more Krampi when they do come. So that's the setting that I have. Survivors. So this is one of the newest settings that they have added into the game. This is actually really nice for people who like to play and have their worlds open to the community. So your starting resources, by default, after day 10, they'll get extra starting resources. So when you come into a world and it's day 11, you might actually have a couple items in your inventory that are for the next season. So if you were gonna have winter as your next season on day 20, day 21, you would actually have some winter gear on your character. You can change this down to always have extra gear after 5 days, after 10 days, after 15, after 20, or never. By default, it is set to 10. I have turned this on off before. I think I've forgotten the last couple of times with my settings and just left it on after day 10. Your starting season, seasonal items, you can have it on none or you can have it on yes. So the game will actually select, oh, this season's about to start, let's give them this item to help them out. Griever protection? No, this isn't. This isn't the friendly griever that we all know and love, spelled completely different. This griever is somebody who comes into your world, steals everything, and then takes off. So griever spawn protection, none. Auto detect, or always. These settings aren't perfect. Auto detect will detect certain items that it knows to be more rare, like an eyeball from Deerclops, a walking cane, or things that take a little bit more to build, and auto remove them from the player as they leave. It also makes it so they can't do certain actions when first coming into the game. I leave this on auto detect. If I had somebody bounce in and then grab a whole bunch of stuff and try and bounce out, it's going to help prevent some of that. Drop items on disconnect. You can have this on default, everything, and that's it. So default, it's only going to drop those specialty rarity items most of the time, depending on how many days they've been in world, or you can have it on everything. The disadvantage of having it on everything, when you're playing in a world and you have people coming and going, and somebody leaves, it's going to drop everything they had on them, which is great. But if they're standing in an area like near your chest or by the fire pit, everything that they have just drops, and then you have a pile of stuff that you need then to move and relocate. I've left this on default in every single game since then. My enlightened monsters, none, little, default, or more. I just leave it on default. These will put you to sleep if you are fully sane on Lunar Island after about two hits, but they're harmful other than that. Sanity monsters, you can have a none, little, default, more. For people who really like to farm nightmare fuel, this is something you can turn on more. Farm all your nightmare fuel and then turn it off. I leave it on default just as a basic setting. It's the way it was, the way the world is. Hound attacks. In our world settings, hound attacks can happen none, little, default, more. On average, around day 7, you might receive your first hound attack. You can actually put this to little, which I believe will get it even lower than that. I think I have actually turned it to little, and it does it every 7 to 10 days. After day 100, you're going to start to see an increased number of hound attacks and hound waves. This is something just to keep you on your toes and to always keep you aware that everything is out to kill you. Starving is the least of your worries. But leaving this at default, I don't see a significant change. I know when I turn it on more, it just happens more frequently. If I'm trying to build a base and do things, I might turn this to little or none. Just to get it done, it is a setting that you can change back later. We've got our frog rain. You can turn this on more, you can turn this on default, little or none. In the past, I've had this on none. I have gone to little, I leave it on default. I think on my last world, I did turn it off because we were trying to build and create, but it is something nice later in the game for meat eaters to have the capabilities to kind of quickly get a ton of meat. For now, we're just gonna keep it on none. Forest petrification. So your trees will turn to stone, which is a new way to get some more stone and resources, even more flint. You can have this happen very fast, default, slow, or none. I leave this on default. It happens fairly quickly. If you leave a forest alone for a while, it will start to petrify. What's nice is if you just keep going back and checking on it, it's going to continue to grow and spread. You can bring a boss like Berger over there. He can knock down all those trees, you collect all the rocks, and then you can take pine cones from another forest and actually plant that down again. Hunts slash surprises, you can have these on none, little, default, more. You guys are probably catching on, these are all the same. Just about, there's only a couple that have slight differences. I leave this on default. Hunts I leave on default. Lightning, if you die from lightning constantly, this is something you can turn to none or little. I've died multiple times running around with little to no health, and I was struck by lightning. I leave this on default. It's part of the game. It's making me become better, learning to deal with lightning. Just make sure you put down a lightning rod. Wildfires. This is a pain. You can have it on more, you can have it on default, you can have it on little, you can have it on none. You will see a difference in the way people play if Wildfires is on none versus having it on even little, default, or more. People who have this on little, default, or more typically will always live in the Oasis, as it's the safest place and is immune to Wildfires. Players that don't have Wildfires on have the freedom and ability to base anywhere and not have to worry about a Wildfire starting, continuing on, and destroying an entire biome. I turn Wildfires off. There used to be something in the game called Disease, which would actually eat away at your plants, and if it wasn't taken care of and eradicated immediately, you could lose an entire crop or all of your berry bushes within an area of the game. So, Wildfires, I keep it on none. I like to base wherever I want. I don't want to have my base in the Oasis just like everybody else. Rain, you can have this on more, default, little, none. I leave it on default. Later in the game, as lag starts to become an issue on console, after about day 600 to 800, depending on your world gen settings, your world will actually start to lag just by the number of items on the map and on your screen. So if you have other players that you want to play with, that's going to help cause more lag. So turning off things like rain can help with the lag. I keep it on until it becomes an issue later on in the game. Meteor frequency, again, this is just how often they're going to strike. You can have it on more, little, none. I leave mine on default. Regrowth multiplier, so how quickly your trees are going to grow. I actually like to turn this on very fast sometimes. It's nice to have things grow quickly. You can have this on fast, you can have it on default, slow or very slow or none. I typically keep this on fast or very fast. You have your birchnut trees, which is a style of trees, how quickly you would like those to grow. I just leave this on default. You have carrots, fast, very fast, slow, very slow, or none. I leave this on default. Your lunar trees, I leave on default. Flowers, default. Trees, default. Salt formations, default. Twiggy trees, default. Let's go down to our creatures. So we have bees. I think I leave Bunnymen, I turn to more, because I like them to come back, because farming them to get puffs to build houses can take a while. Butterflies, I like to turn on more. It's quick, easy sanity food. It's also fun to run around and chase them to get Krampus. Our grass geckos, gobblers, moles, all of these other guys, pigs, rabbits, lobsters, pangolins, I keep on default. The grass geckos, I will leave on default because it's the way the game was intended until later in game when they start to cause more lag, and then I will move it to none. For now, we're going to put it on none. Let's scroll down. These are our hostile creatures. Bats, cookie cutters, frogs, killer bees, hounds, horror hounds, lure plants, mech tusk, merms, sharks, mosquitoes, moonrock pangles, shattered spiders, skitter squids, spider warriors, and spiders. Why are there more hostile creatures than friendly creatures? I just don't get it. No, I get it. Everything's trying to kill you. These, for the majority, I will leave on default. Mactus, just because I don't get too many, I will put on more. But everything else, I leave on default. Merms, I do like to turn on more, but if I am playing with other players, I leave on default just because I want them to feel comfortable coming into the swamp and enjoying the swamp with me. And our giants. So our giants, you can turn these settings to little, none, more. That's it. So for me, if I was going to... Oh, no, I want Crab King. Hey. Antlion, I leave on default. I usually don't mess with them too much because I already have Summer slower. It doesn't seem like that much fun to change him and have more or less. Airdrie I actually put on more. Bee Queen I put on more. Dragonfly I put on more. Deerclops I put on more. Krampus I put on more. Moose Goose I leave default. Poison Birch Nest Trees I actually turn off, which I don't need to because I don't chop those down. I know a lot of players will actually build a full section of birchnut trees and have Berger go through and knock them down very quickly and effectively. That's typically, I think, why I turned it off originally, but it's just become a natural setting. I think I just don't like dealing with them. You can chop down the tree and deal with little eyes. It's hard for new players, and I think I play with a lot of new players, and that's probably why I've kept it off. Lord of the Flies and everybody else, yeah, Moose Goose, everybody else gets saved to default. Once you have all your settings the way that you want them for this first setting, you can actually go over here to the side. You can save as a new preset. We can actually name this preset, you know, new player, or whatever you would like to name it. This is typically the world's set that I will play with new players. Just so that they can kind of learn and grow, and they don't have to deal with everything that's happening all at once, because as they learn and grow, you can add more things in and you can make things more difficult. It's also the way that you want to play. It's up to you. If you want to turn off all the things that killed you your first year, do it. Get better at playing the world, deal with that new season that's going to come up, and then turn those things back on. And as you grow and develop, you're going to get better and last longer and survive longer. So that's it for our basic forest settings. Let's go to our cave settings. Same thing. So we've got our world gen. This you can only set the very first time. So we're going to go through. Let's set our biomes underground, obviously. Cave area, you can't change these because you're just having caves. World size, big or default. I actually like to have big worlds. It's just adding in more things for me. You can leave it on default. Touchstones, rarely used, but you can put this on more, you can put this on less, you can put it on none. If you die down there, you're dead. Typically, if you die downstairs or in the caves, you will need a friend to get you to your dead body, because if you die, you usually drop your lantern or your light source, so it makes it more difficult for you to get back. I will turn this on more for new players. Loops, I set this the same way as I do up top, which is more branches, never loop. It's going to give you kind of that same clockwork pattern of biomes. Fallen survivors, turn this on more. Light holes, I leave it default. Starting resource, I leave it default. You do have classic, you do have highly random. You do not have a plus version for caves. And our resources, you have cave bananas, default, 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 default. I don't think I change any. I think I turn lights on more, just so I get more light bulbs. And I think I always turn reeds on more. The last world I turned reeds on more, and I got 4 reeds in the caves, in the swamp area. So I think I just hit the max number of items, and that's what happened. So it didn't generate as many. Creatures and spawners, your rock lobsters, your rabbit hutches. I like to turn this on more. It's nice to have more rabbits downstairs. Everything else I leave at default. I hate monkeys, and I know a lot of people will just turn this to little or none. But I've seen some other players be really creative with monkeys and farming for nightmare fuel. So I've actually challenged myself to be better at monkeys. So I've been leaving it at default. I would like to get it to more sometime. And then your hostile creatures and spawners. These are the jerks that are everywhere trying to kill you in the dark. Clockworks. I don't see too many down there other than the main ruins area. You can turn them to more if you want to deal with more of them, or you can turn them on less, little, or none. Leave it on default. Cave worms. I would love to turn this off, but they are a big part of the game. It's where you get the larger berry from their head, so you need these to make certain items, so I keep this on default. Bats, nightmare fissures, spiders, stalagmites, spiders, and tentacles. Not too much that I change. I will sometimes turn both of my spider variants off so that I do not have spiders in the caves. I will still mess with bats. And in doing so, when I actually go over to the world settings, I make sure to change it at the bottom of this. So let's start from the bottom and turn off spiders as well. This is really nice if you just don't want to deal with spiders downstairs. I'm sorry to all my Weber fans, but spiders are gross. And especially these ones. I like Weber, but these other ones down here are just kind of gross. And I don't like them. And I usually die from them. Toadstool, I'll turn on more. Tree guards, Lord of the Fruit Fly, I leave on default. Spiders, I have slowly been trying to bring these back. When I'm trying to build a base or do things, I'm trying to challenge myself to be better in caves, so that's why I've turned most of these off. That was 90% of my deaths when I was in caves. And it wasn't the spider necessarily by itself, it was the things that led up to the spider being able to kill me in one hit, because I wasn't well prepared and well equipped. So let's go up from here. We've got creatures. Same as before, later in game I might turn the geckos off just to help with lag. But everything else, I'll leave on default. Moles, if you don't want to lose gunpowder or other rarity items, you can turn moles off, just so you have the freedom of leaving things on the ground. You still can get moles in the caves from earthquakes, so keep that in mind. Just because you turn it off doesn't mean that they're gone forever. You also have resource regrowth, so how quickly you want things to grow. I like to have things grow very fast for light bulbs. Trees you can put on fast. And then for the last setting at the top here, Ancient Guardian Gateway, how quickly it will respawn. I leave this on default. My rain, default. Cave worm attacks, this is the same as hound wave attacks up top. You can have it on more, little, less, or none. Leave it on default. Once you've set these world settings, let's save it as a new preset. Now, you don't want to use the same name, so I'm going to say new player, but we're going to maybe call it... new player, and then we'll write caves, so that we know that this is the caves version. Save. And then if you're going to go through and choose your world's preset, you would select it, and then apply preset, and it'll fill it all out for you. Makes it really quick and easy for you to set this up. Haven't been in world yet, so haven't had any rollbacks, but that's basic world settings for me. I hope you liked this video. I'm sorry it was super long, but thanks for hanging out, and yeah, we'll see you again next time. Don't forget all the things that everybody says, like, subscribe, follow, send a tweet, or all the other fun things. Thank you guys for being here, and have a good one.